How many people remember The Hundreds? The Hundreds was a community-based streetwear brand and media platform with an emphasis on people over product. And throughout the early to mid-2000s, they were among the frontrunners in the golden age of streetwear. Created by Ben and Bobby Hundreds, the line played a huge role in not only bringing streetwear to the fame that it enjoys today, but it helped put LA on the map as one of the street fashion hubs of the world. I'm Nate the Great from TakeFlight214.com. And you know that if The Hundreds managed to make this series, then something happened and they're not quite the hype machine that they used to be. And in today's video, we'll discuss how they rose to fame and what caused the downfall. This is the rise and fall of The Hundreds. But before we get started, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button. It's a small act for you, but a huge favor for us. But with that being said, let's jump right in. It all started when Bobby Kim met his future business partner, Ben, in law school. Bobby always felt the need to shake up the system from the inside, and this was his motivation to go to law school. He originally wanted to be an activist. This outlook is not unlike how he approached the streetwear world in the first place, which was by starting a blog during the early days of Blogspot. And at the time, the blog covered up-and-coming names in skate, hip-hop, and design that generally made up streetwear subculture. The blog was a way to open up the world that Bobby and his friends lived in. They would broadcast live daily from their neighborhood near Fairfax in Los Angeles. The clothing side of the brand was officially launched in 2003, having drawn inspiration from brands such as Supreme, Stussy, A-Life, and many of the other New York brands from the late 90s. Streetwear of the day was extremely exclusive. In fact, that was part of the draw. Many fans made sport of hunting down limited pieces from obscure brands that no one else could find. This was part of the thrill. But Bobby, being the person that he is, wanted to bring a more inclusive aspect to the game. He didn't want to hoard all the info to himself. He wanted to talk about Bathing Ape or the crazy pair of Air Force Ones that he picked up in Tokyo and share it with the world. The internet would wind up facilitating this through his blog. A lot of people wanted to learn about the underground world because until that moment, streetwear had been pretty closed off and clandestine. The community that they built would later serve as a catapult that would launch the clothing side into the forefront of the streetwear game. Like most other brands from that era, The Hundreds started with graphic design t-shirts. They got their inventory out on a barely shoestring budget, with a grassroots street team made up of supremely dedicated early fans spreading the word. They had a pretty clever trick that they would use. They sold their pieces to the hottest shops in town that would carry it. They would then have their friends go back in and ask for it by name and buy it all back. Seems kind of counterintuitive, but there was a method to the madness. These tactics duped the shops into thinking, wow, these guys are pretty popular. We better order more of their stuff. One day, while just kind of doodling, Bobby came up with the Atom Bomb character. A cartoon character explosive, seemingly alarmed by his own lit fuse. He probably had no idea at the time, but the character will become arguably the most recognizable mascot in all of streetwear. And we also have a fun fact that you may or may not have known about the Atom Bomb character, which we'll get to later on in the video, so stay tuned. But anyway, if you watched our Fairfax video, then you know that soon after The Hundreds released their Paisley hoodie, things started to really look up for the business. The Hundreds had began to gain popularity before this, but something about this piece caused an explosion for them. They would sell out of the hoodies within hours of releasing them, netting them around 100 grand in profit. Ben and Bobby wanted to put the windfall profits back into the business, so rather than saving or blowing it, they would use it to secure their very first store, the flagship shop on Fairfax. The building that The Hundreds would inhabit was a pretty good size, so it afforded space for them to set up their office upstairs in one of the extra spaces, but they still had room. But being an inclusive, community-minded person that Bobby is, he decided to rent the extra spaces to a few other brands also getting their start around that time. Brands like Hell's Bells, Crooks and Castles, and Diamond Supply would set up office space upstairs. Dom Kennedy even had a studio there. Today, collaborations are a huge part of streetwear. So much so that some are beginning to ask if it's going a bit too far. But however you feel about collabs now, they played a large role in the ascension of street fashion. And The Hundreds played a big role in making that happen. It really should come as no surprise that the Hundreds has so many collaborations over the years. They were first and foremost a storytelling brand, and working alongside different artists, musicians, and entities has always been a method of telling an intimate story that shows camaraderie and appreciation for the collaborator. Over the years, they've done collabs with tons of people, everyone from Disney to Lance Montoya in 2009. The story behind Montoya collaboration began in the 90s and started with a band named Primus. Primus's album cover art displayed what Bobby described as bizarre sculpture fantasies of grotesque and distorted figures and the cartoonish and unsettling creatures. The man responsible for these works was none other than Oakland-based artist Lance Link Montoya. But he wasn't that easy to find, though. Montoya had a falling out with the band and took on other occupations like construction and miscellaneous odd jobs. He wasn't solely invested into his art, so therefore tracking him down proved to be a pretty difficult feat. Bobby spent months trying to find Montoya, making cold calls through white pages, sending emails to nowhere, and finally trying his hand at snail mail in hopes of, quote, getting a tug on the other end of the line. Miraculously enough, though, the stars would align, and thus the Hundreds by Lance Montoya was born. Though these two would be among the first, they certainly wouldn't be the last. The Hundreds would churn out a copious amount of collabs over the years. Jurassic Park, Looney Tunes, and even flirted with dropping one with Xbox. The Hundreds, along with other core West Coast brands that they came up with, completely changed the look of LA fashion. Before they came around, the LA fashion scene was known for stuff like Von Dutch and Ed Hardy. You know, the whole party like a rock star phase. But the New York and Los Angeles street fashion wave transformed everybody from rock stars into skaters. And the Hundreds played a huge role in this process. Bobby intentionally made lots of black pieces as an homage to the old school NWA and Raider culture of LA's past, mixed with splashes of color for the modern crowd. During the height of the Hundreds run, the Atom Bomb character was one of the most recognizable logos in all of the business. But all of this hype turned out to be a bit of a gift and a curse, or at least as far as Bobby was concerned. While Atom Bomb brought hordes of new fans and gave the Hundreds bankable brand identity all over the world and internet, Bobby didn't love how it distracted people from the designs and became all some people wanted to see from the Hundreds. Overwhelmed with demand, stockists started to only buy the Hundreds products if it had the little cartoon bomb emblazoned somewhere on the garment. And no matter how hard they tried, no matter how many cut and sew pieces they made, most consumers mainly wanted the logo stuff. And now the fun fact that I told you about earlier. While the Hundreds has been synonymous with the Atom Bomb logo for what seems like forever now, you may be surprised to learn that the worried little explosive wasn't their original logo. In fact, Atom Bomb didn't come along until 3 years after the Hundreds launched as a clothing brand. For the first few years, the company didn't even have a logo. Most people were buying the products based on individual designs and not the brand recognition of the Hundreds, i.e. the whole paisley hoodie thing. And even more surprising, to me at least, is that Atom Bomb was almost not chosen to be the logo at all. This thing, known as Bread Man, almost became the mascot for the Hundreds. Playing off America's sudden obsession with removing all, quote, killer carbs from their diet, Bread Man was a smiling, knife and gun wielding, crazy looking slice of white bread. The brand was all set to make it official, but buyers weren't quite into it, for obvious reasons, as you can see. I mean, can you imagine if this thing was the Hundreds logo? To say it doesn't quite have the same draw is a huge understatement. Bobby Hundreds will write a book titled This Is Not a T-Shirt, released in 2019. The book covered everything from his upbringing to his concepts of streetwear as a whole. The Hundreds is a little bit different from some of the other brands in the fact that they didn't quite take a dive like many of the others did in the series. I mean, honestly, they haven't maintained the same level of hype like from back in the day, like Supreme. But they didn't completely go bust either. I think a large part of what's helped them is their blog and Bobby's focus on people over product. A lot of people think streetwear is a subsect of fashion, or that it's just about hype and clothing. And in some ways, it is. But the overlap of culture, content, and commerce, it's so much more than just that. Bobby Hundreds may have put it best in saying streetwear without culture is just fashion. And since its inception, the Hundreds has always been a two-part project, a classic Californian streetwear brand and a media platform dedicated to global street culture. And it's this, perhaps, that's helped keep the mind fresh in the minds of an ever-evolving industry, albeit though their clothes may not be at the height that they once were. So what do you think? Are you still a fan of the Hundreds? Would you wear their pieces today? Or better yet, do you read the blog? Hit us up in the comment section and let us know. Also, if you made it this far, then you must have enjoyed the video. So if you drop us a like, then we really appreciate it as it helps us spread and grow as a channel. We do an edition of Rise and Fall of Streetwear Brand every week. And if you'd like to be reminded each time we drop a new episode, then hit the sub and the notification bell to be updated each time we drop a new entry. With that being said, I'm Nate the Great from TakeFlight214.com signing out. Until next time, peace.